regarding organising our prayers around our life. You know, SubhanAllah, prayer is the most important, you know, issues for us to be paying attention to. But how easy is it for us to just put it on the side? You know, we end up doing everything else and we neglect our prayers in the end. You know, we get so busy with our lives, we get so busy with the dunya and all of our responsibilities, and we start to slowly neglect our prayers and put them to the side, but we don't realize that what we should be doing is trying to always make it a priority to organize our lives around our prayers and not organize our prayer around our life. Because once you start to organize your prayer around your life, you end up neglecting the prayers. You end up missing prayers even, because you just try to stick in your prayer wherever you can find time to put it in. And that's not what we should be trying to do. We know our prayer times. Yes, we do have a few hours in general to pray those prayers. Like, we don't have to pray them in the beginning of the time, but the more you neglect it towards the end, slowly you end up getting to a situation where you end up missing the prayer completely. So that's why it shouldn't be our habit to constantly be praying our prayers towards the end of their times. Our habit should be trying to establish the prayer for the beginning of their times, and then sometimes, due to a situation or another that's out of our control, we might delay it, you know, a bit longer. So we should be trying to aim to pray our prayer within at least the first hour, and then, you know, like, sometimes things will come up where we might have to delay a little bit longer than that, but in general, that should be our aim. That should be our goal every day. Once we've got that, we start to organize our life around our prayers. So SubhanAllah, even when it comes to good deeds, we have to realize that, you know, a lot of people, like, you might get really busy doing good deeds, like helping sisters outside the house, you know, working with a charity, whatever you're doing, and then sometimes you forget to prioritize your prayers. Like, even good deeds, other good deeds, are not on the same level as praying your five prayers on time. Like, that is a priority. Even when someone asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what is the most beloved of all deeds to Allah? What is the most beloved deeds to Allah? He said, As-salatu ala waqtiha. The prayer in its time. The more prayer in general is prayed towards the beginning of the time, the more love that prayer is to Allah. There are some exceptions in that. Like Aisha, it is loved to delay the prayer if you're not praying in Jama'ah. It is loved to delay it, you know, a bit later, but not too late. And also Dhuhr, if it's very hot, it is from the Sunnah to delay Dhuhr prayer slightly when it's hot. Yani, this is from the Sunnah. But in general, praying the prayer towards the beginning of the time, this should be our aim. And this is, you know, if we're striving for good deeds, we're hoping to please Allah with our life, then this should be our aim, inshallah, trying to pray the prayer towards the beginning of the time. Because it's from the most loved of deeds, as we said, to Allah Azza wa Jal. Now, we have to realize that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us that the prayer is nur, the prayer is light. So this is how much you're in need for prayer in your life. You're so desperately in need for prayer in your life because prayer is nur, it is the light of your life. Without prayer, your life becomes a life of darkness, a life of emptiness, a life of ignorance. You don't know where you're going in life. Whereas when you're stuck to your prayers, SubhanAllah, you see the blessing that Allah places in your life. He places blessing in your family. He places blessing in your household. He gives you guidance in your life. You can see clearly the matters, you know, the differences between the good and the evil. Like, people who are not stuck to their prayers, it's very difficult for them to see what is haram and what is halal. But when you're stuck to the prayers, Allah gives you furqan, like, He gives you a criterion that you can distinguish between what is something hated to Allah and what is something which is good and tayyib and loved and halal. You get that feeling in your heart, subhanAllah. But without prayers, you won't have that developed within yourself. That's why the Allah Ta'ala says, "Inna salata tanha 'anil fahsha'i wal munkar." That the prayer forbids a person from fahsha and munkar. It forbids the person from evil and, you know, from doing sins. It stops you, subhanAllah. It gives you self-control. That's what prayer does. It's a light in your life that helps you get self-control. When you're able to pray your prayers on time, you'll find all the other aspects of your life will start to fall into place. I can testify this to for my own self when I first, subhanAllah, embraced Islam all those years ago. And as much as I believed in Allah, but it wasn't until I actually started praying my five prayers on time that I really felt my whole life just fell into place. I knew where I was going, and I really felt that direction in life. It keeps you on track. But if you start to neglect your prayers, you start to not pray them, you see how your life feels like a mess. You go to bed at night, you feel like your life is in a mess. So what is the key to fixing up our life and fixing our life? Start with the prayers. Pray your prayers on time, and subhanAllah, you'll see how your life just starts to fall into place without you even trying, subhanAllah. And we have to realize that for those people who don't pray, you know, they don't pray at all, like, a'udhu billah, like, they don't realize how much they are in darkness in this world, the emptiness they have in their hearts. And then the sad thing is, when they go to their graves in the next life, all they find is the darkness of the qabr. All they find is the darkness of the grave surrounding them. May Allah protect us. Because we have to realize that the salah is nur. It is light for the believer. And just like you were looking after your salah in this life, and it was a nur for you in this life, the salah will be a nur for you in your grave. It will surround you, and it will be, subhanAllah, a comfort for you, subhanAllah, in the darkness of your grave. And similarly, on the sirat, on the bridge over the hellfire, which is so dark, you can't see anything. It's blacker than the darkest night. And yet, subhanAllah, due to your prayers and your amal salihat, your righteous deeds, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you a light to be able to see your way in crossing over the sirat, over the bridge over the hellfire, subhanAllah. So we have to realize that, you know, prayer is such an important part of our lives, and we need to establish our households upon the prayer. If you want success in your family, if you want success in your marriage, then you have to establish your household upon the prayer. And this is why you find the prophets and the anbiya, they used to make du'as to Allah to keep their families and themselves steadfast upon the prayer. For example, we see how Ibrahim alayhi salam, he used to make the du'a, رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ دُعَا. So he used to say, O Allah, make us, you make me from those who establish the prayers, and from my offspring and my children. Make us all from those who are steadfast upon the prayer. O Allah, accept my dua. Because he knows that, subhanAllah, the prayer is the key to success in keeping your household on track, keeping your household together, not going through grief later on if your children go astray because you didn't bring them up on the prayers. How many sad stories have we seen of people crying over their children, all because they didn't bring up their children upon the prayer? And then later on you see the effects of that. They were so worried to bring up their kids as doctors, as engineers, as having a really great career, but they didn't pay attention to making sure that their children were stuck to a salah. And then you have to suffer the pain of that, subhanAllah. You suffer the consequences of that later on. And it's not something that anybody wants to go through. Like, you would prefer to not have money in this world than to see your own children go astray and go off the straight path. It is more painful than that. May Allah protect us and keep our kids firm upon the straight path. And we see how Ismail alayhi salam, like, We see how Allah Ta'ala, He described Ismail, وَكَانَ يَأْمُرُ أَهْلَهُ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ وَكَانَ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ مَرْضِيًّا. So Allah Ta'ala tells us how that Ismail, he used to command his family بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ to establish the prayer and establish the zakah. وَكَانَ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ مَرْضِيًّا. So Allah Ta'ala was pleased with him due to the way he was living his life, stuck to the prayers and stuck to performing a zakah. And we see also how Allah Ta'ala, the first thing He says to Musa, وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي, and perform the prayer in order to remember me. If you want to be close to Allah and you want to be from those who are from the dhakirin, those who remember Allah and remember, yani if you say you love Allah, the sign of your love for Allah and remembering Him is your prayer and your dedication to the prayer. So we have to put our priorities into order. So this is why, dear sisters, we see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was always emphasizing with the companions about the prayer over and over again. Like, we cannot have enough lessons reminding us about our prayers, because prayers is something we have to do every day. And there are times where I know you get lazy with your prayer. Things happen, you start to go backwards a little bit with your prayers. That's why we need to have constant reminders of the prayer. And you see, that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was constantly reminding the Sahaba and reminding this Ummah of the importance of the prayers. I mean, you think about it, sisters, we are going through hard times as Muslims. We are going through trials and tribulations. How do you expect to keep yourself steadfast through these trials and through these hardships if you're not at least keeping yourself steadfast through your prayer? You need it. It's your connection to Allah. It is your lifeline to Allah. Yani, if you let go of the lifeline, what's going to happen to you? You're going to drown. You're going to drown in these waves of fitna. You're going to drown in these waves of hardship and trials. It's so easy to slip off the path of Allah if you're not holding on tight. You have to keep holding on and making yourself steadfast. Even if it's hard, even if you struggle with yourself, you might be really down. You might feel like I don't have anything left in me even to pray. Just get up and push yourself, even if you don't even want to pray. Push yourself to pray, sisters. Keep pushing yourself, and subhanAllah, you'll see how very soon you want to pray. It's a matter of habit. Prayer is also a matter of habit. The more you push yourself, even against your own nafs, when it's telling you, no, I don't want to pray, push yourself against it. Don't give in to the shaitan. Don't give in to your nafs who's heavy on yourself trying to push you not to pray. Keep pushing against it. Push against the tide, and subhanAllah, give it some time. You'll see that slowly you'll want to pray, and you'll look back and think, alhamdulillah, I stayed steadfast because now it's easy for me once you get over that hurdle. So we have to realize that all success is to be found through the prayer. You want success in this life? It weighs so heavily on your prayers. Success in this life and success in the akhirah. You cannot have success in this life nor the akhirah unless, subhanAllah, you're stuck to the prayers. Let's talk about some of the benefits of the prayer that we're getting every time we pray. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us that if one of you had a river flowing in front of your house and you took a bath in it 5 times a day, would there be any dirt left upon you? And so, of course, the companions, they said, no, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so he told them that is exactly like the prayers, the 5 prayers, that Allah continues to wipe away your sins and to wash away your sins through your prayers. That's the effect. You're constantly getting purification through your prayers. So subhanAllah, like if you pray dhuhr, it wipes, if you pray your midday prayer, it wipes up the minor sins that came before it. And if you pray asr, your afternoon prayer, it's wiping out and expiating for sins that came between, minor sins that you have done. between the midday prayer and the afternoon prayer. And even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he tells us, how is it, how do the prayers come off a person when they pray? So he tells us in a sahih narration in Al-Bayhaqi, he tells us that when the believer stands before Allah in his prayers, his sins are brought and gathered and placed upon his head and his shoulders. Okay, so when you go to pray before Allah, the sins are placed, or they're gathered on the person's head and shoulders. And so when they make ruku', when they make bowing in their prayer, and they make sajda, when they make the prostration in the prayer, the sins are falling down from you. Each time you do that, you don't realize the sins are falling down from you through those actions of ruku' and sujood, subhanAllah. So you're becoming purified each time. You're getting closer to Allah. Each time you pray to Allah, you're getting closer to Him. He's wiping away those sins. He's purifying you. We're in need for constant purification. We're always in need for constant purification, subhanAllah. So this is why, you know, also, you know, from the sunnah to lengthen the ruku' as well, to lengthen the bowing, to lengthen the prostration. You know, subhanAllah, if you know how much that's good for you, this also encourages you, inshallah, to want to lengthen your sajda. And you see that the righteous salaf, how much they would lengthen their ruku', how much they would lengthen the sujood. Even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, like for example, it's mentioned by about Sufyan al-Thawri that he prayed in Mecca in the Haram. He prayed the sunnah of Maghrib, and he stayed in sajda. They said from the time of the sunnah of al Maghrib all the way up until the adhan for Aisha. SubhanAllah, this is how much he wants to seek nearness to Allah through his sujood. And we know, sisters, that the sujood, when you're in the sujood, when you're in the prostration to Allah, this is the closest place in this dunya that a person comes to Allah. Like, you're in the closest position to be, yani, in this whole world to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you're in your sujood. So if you think about that, no wonder the righteous believers of the past wanted to stay that long in that position, because they know that this is how they're close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this position, subhanAllah. Okay, we need to also realize that, you know, seeing Allah in the next life, this is the greatest joy for every believer. Seeing Allah, seeing your Creator, seeing Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the Most Merciful, in the next life, this is the greatest blessing the believer will be given in the Akhirah. It is going to be more loved to you than anything you're given in the Jannah. Every believer looks forward to Jannah. You look forward to what you're going to be given in the Jannah, but everything in Jannah is nothing in comparison to the gift and the blessing of seeing Allah in the next life. This is the greatest joy and blessing that Allah will bestow upon the believers. Like Allah says, وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ, that faces on that day will be full of light and bright and lit up with joy. إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ, looking towards their Lord. SubhanAllah. And subhanAllah, so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has shown us that seeing Allah in the next life, it has a link to your prayers in this dunya. It has a link to your prayers in this dunya. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he tells us that verily you will see your Lord just as you see the moon on a night when the moon is full. And you don't have any difficulty in seeing the moon. Like, just as easily as you can see the moon on a full night when it's clear and there's no clouds, that's how easy it's going to be for you to see Allah in the next life. So he says in this hadith, so if you are able not to miss the prayer before the sun rises, talking about the Fajr prayer, if you're able to not miss the prayer before the sun rises, the Fajr prayer, and if you're able to not miss the praying before the sunset, like, you know, in other words, the Asr prayer, the afternoon prayer, then you should do so. So what does this hadith show us? It shows us that praying your fajr prayer, like, don't be negligent. Don't just wake up and pray your fajr prayer at 7 o'clock in the morning or 8 o'clock in the morning. If you really want to see Allah in the next life, you will take care of your prayers, not to pray them, like, not to pray them out of their times. Not to pray fajr after the sunrise. Not to pray asr, towards the sunset or after the sunset. You'll be careful with those prayers because it shows how much you want to see Allah in the next life. Now, we have to also realize, dear sisters, that the first thing that a believer is going to be asked about from the Amal on Yawm al-Qiyamah is the prayers. The prayers are the first thing. You're not going to be asked about your sadaqah first. You're not going to be asked about other good deeds that you did in this life first. You're going to be asked about your prayers. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he tells us, فَإِن صَلَحَتْ فَقَدْ أَنْجَحْ وَأَفْلَحْ وَإِن فَسَدَتْ فَقَدْ خَابَ وَخَسِرْ. So he says that if the person's prayers was sound, then he will be successful. He'll be from the successful on Yawm al-Qiyamah. But if his prayers were corrupted, then he will be from the losers on Yawm al-Qiyamah. So you have to realize that prayers is linked with your overall success. And let me tell you, sisters, that if you see people who go around causing strife in the community and doing fitna and doing oppressions, let me tell you, there is something wrong with their prayers. There is something wrong with their prayers. Either they don't pray their prayers on time, or when they pray them, they're praying them up and down and having no khushu whatsoever, and just, praying them so fast, not praying them in the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered. Because we know that Allah said, Inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. If a person is really praying the prayer, focusing on their prayer when they're praying to Allah, knowing that Allah is watching them in their prayer, feeling the presence of standing before Allah in their prayer, okay? If they're praying in such a way, how on earth could they leave their prayer and go and cause fitna in the community, backbiting, causing all kinds of strife? No, it can't be possible, because if they knew Allah in their prayer, they would know Allah outside their prayer. So we know if someone is doing kinds of corruptions in the earth, they don't know Allah in their prayer. There's something very wrong with this person in their way they're praying to Allah. And that's what you'll see, that when they come on Yawm al-Qiyamah, it's because there was something wrong with their prayers. This is why other aspects of their prayer, their life, will also be a failure as well. So that's why, Yani, when you get your prayer in order, you'll see how you become more conscious of Allah in every aspect of your life. It causes you to strive for the Akhirah because you're conscious. You've got that conscious reminder 5 times a day, at the minimum, 5 times a day of remembering Allah and striving for the Akhirah. And so therefore, what does that do? You don't just stop at prayers, you start looking for other avenues of good deeds. So maybe you start fasting more, maybe you start giving sadaqah more, you start trying to help sisters, you improve your akhlaq, you improve your behaviour. You're better with your husband, you're better with your children, you're better with, subhanAllah, your life in general. This is the difference, Yani. This is the effect we should be seeing of a person who is really praying the way that Allah has, wants us to stand before Him in the prayers. And the other thing is too that, you say you love the Rasul, you say you love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you wish to see him in the Akhirah, isn't it true? You wish to see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's a wish, yes. Let's look at what did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say to one of the companions who wished to be with him in the Jannah. Did he say it's enough for you just to wish? Let's have a look. So subhanAllah, Rabi' bin Malik, he used to help the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in taking wudu. He used to bring the water for him and help him sallallahu alaihi wasallam in washing for the wudu. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw in the face of Rabi' bin Malik the sincerity, like how much he loves righteous deeds, he's humbling himself so much because he's just looking for any deed to get close to Allah. Like he's even ready to bring the water to help the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in washing his feet because of his love for the Akhirah. And so then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says to Rabi' bin Malik, he says to him, ask me what you wish. And so what does Rabi' bin Malik say? Does he ask him for something from the dunya? Does he ask him for money because maybe he's not got enough to eat for him and his family? He says to him, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I want your company in the Jannah. I just want to be with you in the Jannah, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so what did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tell him? What was his advice? Did he tell him, that's okay, as long as you love me, you'll be with me, or just keep hoping, it's all right? He told him, help me with yourself by increasing your sujood. Help me with yourself by increasing your sujood. Like, we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam can make shafa'ah for us on Yawm al-Qiyamah. He can make intercession for us. And for his love for us on the day of resurrection, he's going to make intercession for his ummah, for his nation. We know that. But at the same time, if you want to be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the akhirah, if you truly love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as you say, then the way to do that is by increasing your sujood, increasing your salah, and praying extra prayers, and being careful with your prayers. So this is why, dear sisters, praying nawafil, praying extra prayers, is so recommended in Islam. Not to just depend upon your fard prayers, but to also increase upon your fard prayers by praying nawafil, praying extra sunnah prayers. Because on Yawm al-Qiyamah, as we said, the first thing that Allah is going to look at are your fard prayers. Alright, He's going to look at your fard prayers first. Now, if your fard prayers were complete, then alhamdulillah, you'll be fine. But if there's something lacking in your fard prayers, there's something deficient in your fard prayers, there were days where you might have, you know, not prayed properly, you hardly concentrated at all, so you really got really nothing out of your prayer, you know, things like that, or maybe you missed a few prayers here and there, or Allahu alam, there's little deficiencies that come in the prayers. So then Allah will say to His malaika, to the angels, look and see their nawafil prayers. Go and look and see their extra prayers. And so the malaika will look at that person's extra prayers, and they will see, and they'll look at their record, and if they find extra prayers, they find extra sunnah prayers, extra voluntary prayers, then those prayers will be taken and make up for any deficiencies in the fard prayers. And so their prayers will become complete by that. However, imagine how it's going to be for that person who had negligence in their prayers, but they didn't used to pray sunnah. They didn't used to pray extra prayers. How are they going to make up for the deficiencies in their fard prayers? So that's why it's so encouraged for us to also not just rely only on praying our fard prayers, but to try to pray extra sunnah prayers as much as we can. And we see the righteous salaf, the righteous believers, they used to, subhanAllah, they used to pray so many extra prayers. SubhanAllah, how much blessing they had in their days compared to us. Like Imam Ahmad, rahimallah, it's reported that he used to pray 100 rak'ah. Every single day he used to pray 100 rak'ah on top of his five prayers. That's on top of all his lessons that he used to give, and his fatawa that he used to, you know, teaching, and all the things that he used to do in his day, he still has time to find to pray 100 rak'ah. Look at us. Wala hawla wala quwwata illa billah. We're struggling just to pray five prayers a day. Where's our barakah in our life? SubhanAllah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, whoever prays 12 rak'ah besides the fard prayers, like if they pray 12 rak'ah in a day and night, Allah will build for that person a house in Jannah. Allah will build for you a castle in Jannah. How many of you are saving up for a big, beautiful house? Anyway, most people, they always wish they can have some beautiful house on a hill, looking over a beautiful scene, like looking over the ocean, looking over a river or a lake, something beautiful to retire to. SubhanAllah. Why don't we wish for the castle in the Akhirah, which is, you know, beyond anything you've ever seen in this dunya. SubhanAllah. All you have to do to get it is just to pray two rakat of sunnah before the Fajr prayer, the morning prayer, and four rakat before your midday prayer, and two rakat after it, and two rakat after Maghrib, the sunset prayer, and two rakat after Isha. If you make that as your habit, that's your life savings towards a castle in the next life. You didn't have to work and, you know, get money for it. You just have to put in your investment every single day of praying your 12 nawafi. That's all that it takes from you. SubhanAllah. Inshallah, with insincerity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the castle in the Jannah, inshallah, ya Rabbil Alameen. On top of that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned to us some specific virtues of some of these prayers I just mentioned, these sunnah prayers. For example, he tells us that the two rak'ah before Fajr are better than whatever is in this world. It's better than this world and whatever is in it. Just two rak'ah, just two units of prayer before your Fajr prayer is better for you than everything in this dunya. It's more precious and it's worth more than whatever is in this dunya, and this dunya, whatever is in it. Now, because the Prophet knew how precious and dear and heavy these prayers were, if you look at his sunnah, you see he never ever missed these prayers. The two rak'ah before Fajr, he never missed them. Even if he's traveling, whatever the situation, he never misses these two rak'ah. And that's why, dear sisters, as well, if the adhan was called and you pray your fard for Fajr, it's legislated for you to even pray the sunnah after the fard. In this case, if you couldn't pray it before Fajr because, you know, you go to the mosque, for example, or you're praying Jama'ah with the family and they already set up the prayer to pray Fajr and you've run out of time to pray your sunnah, it's legislated for you to pray the two sunnah after the Fajr prayer in this case. Not all the time, shouldn't be our habit, but if we missed it, we are allowed to make up for it to pray after the Fajr prayer and not miss it because of how dear and precious that prayer is. And you know that you're not allowed to pray other prayers after Fajr. So it's an exception. It's an exception to the rule. Okay, and then if we look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, also he used to take care in praying the four sunnah prayers before the midday prayer. He used to take great care in praying the four sunnah prayers before the midday prayer, to the level, sisters, that if he ever missed them because he got busy, like maybe sometimes people would come to see him and he got delayed, so he missed praying his four sunnah prayers before dhuhr, he used to sometimes pray them after Asr or before Asr. So he wouldn't miss them completely. He would make up for them after. So he would take care with, you know, making up for them because he knows the value of these prayers. And then when the Prophet ﷺ was asked, Ya Rasulullah, why are you so careful about these prayers? Why are you so careful about these sunnah prayers before dhuhr? He said to the Sahaba, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, this is a time when the heavens are open, and I like it for me to be seen to doing a righteous deed. When the heavens are open, he wants to be upon a righteous deed when the heavens are open. So this is why he used to be so diligent in praying these four sunnah prayers. So this is in relation to the 12 prayers of the day and night. They're called Durawati prayers. Why are they called Durawati prayers? Because they're connected to the five prayers. They're specifically connected to the five prayers. There are other prayers we can pray too. I'm not going to go into that. Yes, you can pray four rakat before asr, but it's not included in the Durawati. Okay, but there are other narrations that mention and pray two rakat between every adhan and iqamah. There are many other prayers, but we're just talking about the 12 prayers of the day and night. This is the ones, the two before Fajr, the four before Dhuhr, the two after Dhuhr, the two after Maghrib, and the two after Isha. Another of the prayers we should not neglect as well is the witr prayer. Okay, the witr prayer, to pray it either before sleeping, or if we're going to wake up and pray Qiyam al-Layl, the night prayer, we should pray the witr prayer at the end. And you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us make witr, because Allah is witr and He loves the witr in number. Make witr. Witr means, the literal meaning of witr means odd. It means odd. So he said, make the witr, pray the witr, pray the odd prayer, because Allah is witr. He's odd, like He's one. Allahu wahid. And He loves the odd. Like He loves, subhanAllah. We see that, for example, isn't there seven heavens? It's odd number, yeah? And Allah Ta'ala is al-wahid. La sharika lah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is another prayer that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he never used to miss it. Even when he's traveling, he doesn't miss the witr prayer. And witr prayer, sisters, you can even pray it as one rakah. Even as one rakah. But the best is to pray it as three. To pray three rakah. And the best is to pray two rakah first and do taslim, and then one rakah separate. That's the best. But you can pray three rakah joined together without taslim, only in the end. Sorry, tashahud. You can pray three rakat joined together. You don't stick to tashahud until the last rakat. That's the second best way to pray witr. The way that's disliked to pray witr is to pray it like maghrib. This is disliked for you to pray witr. The same way you pray maghrib, where you do two tashahuds. Another of the prayers that's loved by Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he advised many of his Sahaba, including Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu and Abu Dharr and many other of the Sahaba, about the Duha prayer. About the Duha prayer, which is the, you could say, the morning, like it's the morning prayer, like after the sun has risen. And he informed us that in every day there is a sadaqah that is due on a person. Like every day you have a sadaqah, a charity that is due on every joint and bone of your body, which equals 360 sadaqah. So he tells us that when you do tasbih, when you say subhanallah, that's a sadaqah. When you say alhamdulillah, that's a sadaqah for you. When you say tahleel, like you say la ilaha illallah, that's a sadaqah. When you say Allahu Akbar, that's a sadaqah for you, right? If you encourage someone to do something good and remind them of something, that's a sadaqah for you. If you forbid the munkar and you speak against something which is evil, that's a sadaqah for you. But what is sufficient to make up for all of that charity is just praying two rakat of duha. Two rakah of duha. This is in Sahih Muslim, this hadith. So the two rakah of duha is a sadaqah. It equals a sadaqah on every single joint of your body. Look how simple. You're thanking Allah for your body, for what He's blessed you with, just by praying two rakah. It's a sadaqah. Because everything, every blessing Allah has given us, dear sisters, there's a sadaqah due for it. We need to give charity, because when you give charity on what Allah has given you, He blesses you in what He's given you. When you give charity, when you give sadaqah on what Allah has blessed you with, He increases the blessing in that thing. So if you want blessing in your health, if you want Allah to preserve you, then this is why we should be more careful in praying duha, because you're thanking Allah for what He's given you of your body. May Allah give us al-afiyah. May he give us health, inshallah, and keep us in a state of health, because we know health is the greatest wealth. SubhanAllah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam also, he mentioned that the prayer of duha is the prayer of the awabeen. The prayer of duha is the prayer of the awabeen. What does it mean? It means it is the prayer of those who turn to Allah in repentance. You know, they have that characteristics of turning back to Allah. So when you stick to duha, it shows that you're from those people who you know you've got Allah, Lord, who is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, and you want to turn to Him. He's At-Tawwab. He's the one who pardons. He's Al-Afu, who pardons the sins. And subhanAllah, so we turn back to Him in repentance constantly. This is the, and Allah loves those who turn back to Him. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ التَّوَّابِينَ وَيُحِبُّ الْمُتَطَّهِرِينَ. Allah loves those who are from the tawabeen, who constantly turn back to Him in repentance and just turn back to Him in general, and they purify themselves constantly. So, and so this is yani the virtues of the duha. And then of course the best prayers after the fard prayers are the night prayers. These are the heaviest, you know, subhanAllah, in the scales after the fard prayers. Then we should try to pray qiyam al-layl, which is the night prayers. And the best time to pray qiyam al-layl is in the last third of the night. This is the best time to pray qiyam al-layl. So there's many extra prayers. In general, you can be praying all day and all night. There are prayers all times of the day and night, subhanAllah. But we restrict ourselves thinking that it's only five prayers. But there's so much more we could be doing if we want to seek nearness to Allah, and if we want to be close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the next life. Now the last thing we need to speak about today, which is really important, is about having khushu' in our prayers. Having humility and humbleness, and feeling, you know, feeling that we're standing before Allah in our prayers, and having submission in our prayers to Allah. This is something we need to pay great attention to, because sisters, the prayer was not prescribed upon us just as a mechanical action. And that's why we see, like we said before, why do so many people not have, why are the Muslims so weak in their iman today? Why are the Muslims so weak in their iman today? Because prayers became a mechanical action for them. And the prayer without khushu' is like a body without a soul. The prayer without khushu' is like a body without a soul. It's not alive. Okay? So this is why it doesn't have effect on them. They don't get the benefits. They don't get the true benefits of praying due to this. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he saw someone rushing in their prayer, not taking their time in their bowing, not taking their time in their sajda, just pecking at the floor, you know, they go sajda like this, quickly like that, like, you know, just for 1 second touching the floor, as you see lots of people doing, or doing ruku', not really, you're not staying, not becoming, stable in their, you know, bowing, and they stand up and they don't even make their backbone straight, they just come up quickly and go straight down. He told the person who did this, go back, for you have not prayed. How can you get for sure if you're just pecking in your prayer? There's no way. So obviously if you're praying like that, you're praying in a very mechanical way. It's going to have absolutely no effect on you whatsoever. That's why the Prophet ﷺ told the man who did that, go back, for you have not prayed. It's like you haven't prayed at all. Allah told us that from the characteristics of the successful believers, if you want success as a believer, He tells us, قَدَ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. That those believers will be successful who have khushu' in their prayers. This is the path to success. If you want to be successful, it's through having khushu' in your prayer. And subhanAllah, all we can say is ilahi mushtaka. Like, to Allah, we can only complain of ourselves when we compare our prayers, our quality of prayer, to the prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba and the righteous Salaf. Like, their prayer was, the difference between their prayer and our prayer is like the difference between the heaven and the earth, subhanAllah. Like, the quality of prayer they had. Like, we see the effect of the prayer on them. How many times the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was praying and his tears were dripping down his blessed beard onto the floor. SubhanAllah, help from the effect of the prayer on himself. You know, it's mentioned that they would hear him crying in his prayer, like the sound of a pot when it's boiling. That's the sound that's coming in his chest, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the khushu' in his prayer. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he stands in front of Allah, you know the reason why they didn't used to like to make Abu Bakr the imam? Because no sooner does he start reading Al-Fatiha, he breaks down in tears before Allah. He was so soft-hearted, that's why sometimes they would say, no, we don't want Abu Bakr to lead us in prayer, because as soon as he starts praying, he straight away starts crying, he makes everybody still, else starts crying. You know, subhanAllah, so this was the difference in their prayers. You know, subhanAllah, like, even there's stories that talk about how one of them will take wudu, and you look at their face has become white and changed. Why? Because, you know, why? Because they're having awe of Allah. Like, they know they're about to meet Allah. So they're so affected by knowing they're about to stand in front of Allah. They have khawf. They have fear in their hearts, knowing they're about to stand before Allah. But look at us. Before we're about to pray, we're joking around, taking it easy. We're not prepping ourselves up. We're not gearing ourselves up for this serious moment when we're going to stand before Allah. And that's why the prayer is khafif on us. It's light. We don't get the effects on Allah. And you know, sisters, if we look at the prayer of the Salaf, you know, the sad thing is that's why they get to look so much forward to their prayer. They used to long for their prayers, long. Can you imagine that? When was the last time we longed for our prayer? Like, we sit here and think, I can't wait till I pray dhuhr. They actually used to long for their prayers. Can you imagine? One of them, he said, there was not one prayer that I performed except that I would look forward to praying it since the time that I embraced al-Islam. From the time he had become Muslim, there wasn't one prayer that he didn't look forward to. He couldn't wait for the moment just to stand before Allah Azza wa Jalla. Look at the difference. Why? Because the quality was completely different. You know, subhanAllah, sisters, the sad thing is, when they had hardship, they had their prayer. When we have hardship, let's be honest, what do we have? I'm not putting people down, but this is the reality. We go to antidepressants. They didn't have antidepressants in their time. They didn't have antidepressants. I know there is a need sometimes for antidepressants. I'm not going to try and put someone down if they're on it. But look at the reality. The reality is if you've got a prayer to that level of strength, honestly, you would not need antidepressants, because it'll overcome the positivity that you get out of that prayer of being close to Allah and overcoming, you know, escaping, really, truly escaping from the dunya. It will overcome any negative feelings. It would override negative feelings, subhanAllah, or any feelings of hardship. That is a reality. But it's very hard. It's not easy to reach that level. But we can if we ask Allah. If Allah makes it easy for us, if we make dua, we can ask Allah to help us to achieve that level. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah made the prayer qurratu ayni. He made it the coolness and happiness of my eyes. That was his escape. How is it that the Prophet ﷺ buried children? He buried with his own hands even wives. They died in his lifetime. He went through so many tragedies, so many hard, sad times. But yet, he's always got a smile on his face. He went through tragedies that me and you have never gone through, such tragedies and hardships. The whole world is against him. If you feel like the world's against you now, sisters, if you feel like the media's against you, the politicians are against you, you feel like the world is caving in on us as Muslims, wallahi, that is nothing in comparison to what was going on in the time of the Prophet when they were going through the the hard days of Mecca when the whole world was against them. Only a couple of mu'mineen in a whole world of disbelief. Imagine that, and you're the one who is on your shoulders to bring Tawheed and bring the light of Islam to this whole world. It's on you. It's your mas'uliyah. Can you imagine that? And your own family even is against you. Everyone's against you. SubhanAllah. You've only got Allah and SubhanAllah what Allah has given you from a few of the believers. So imagine that. But yet, he's always got a smile on his face. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What is the key? Because SubhanAllah, first of course, is getting the wahi from Allah. The revelation from Allah, the Qur'an, is lifting his heart every day, every night. He's lifted with the Qur'an. And we can lift ourselves too if we're close to the Qur'an. Okay? We can lift ourselves as well if we're always close to the Qur'an. And his prayer, which is connection with Allah. He gets that real connection with Allah Azza wa Jalla. So this is the difference, dear sisters. The prayer was their relief from their stress, their relief from the hardship. They didn't have other forms of relief. So they had only one thing to turn to, and you know, that was the best thing, in fact. But because we have alternatives now, we might not put so much emphasis or effort into trying to get the relief in other ways. Okay, so let's talk also now about how to get khushu'. What's some tips on how to get khushu'? One of the ways is to make yourself feel that this could be your last prayer. If you think about it, every one of us sisters is going to die between two prayers. Every one of us is going to die between two prayers. The prayer you previously prayed and the prayer you're about to pray. So which one is it going to be? Allahu alam. We don't know which is the prayer that's going to be our last prayer for our life. So if you think about that and you think this could be my last prayer I'm ever going to pray, this can help you inshallah to have more khushu', because you want your last prayer to be the best prayer, isn't it? And then on top of that, sisters, we need to try to make ourselves feel when we're praying as if you can see Allah. And if you can't get that feeling, then develop the feeling yourself, Allah can see you. And تَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ فَإِنْ لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ. To worship Allah as if you can see Him. And if you can't see Him, then He can see you. Develop that feeling yourself that He is in, you know, you're standing in front of Him. He's watching you right now. You are communicating with Him. And ask yourself, dear sisters, how much are you longing to see Allah in the next life? How much are you longing to meet with Allah in the next life? If you can try to think that each time that you go to your prayer, you're meeting with Allah in this dunya before the akhirah. You're meeting with Allah in this dunya before the akhirah. So if you want your meeting with Allah to be a beautiful meeting, start by making your meeting in this dunya with Allah a beautiful meeting. That's why Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he said, there's two stations for a person. If one of them is good, the other will be good as well. So he said, if one of them is ruined, the other one will be ruined. So they said, what are those two stations? He said, the first one is the person's prayer in this world. And the second is his being brought to account by Allah on the day of resurrection. So if you, you know, can seek nearness to Allah in your prayer and be close to Allah in your prayer, then this is a good sign for you, inshallah, for your meeting with Allah in the akhirah when you stand before Allah on your qiyamah. So the quality of your prayer is linked to how easy it's going to be for you when you meet with Allah on the day of resurrection. Look at it like that as well. The other thing the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us as well is, you know, if you get the shaitan stuff to come to you, you find your mind is getting distracted, you're thinking about what to do, or do this, or do that, You say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim in your prayer, and you turn slightly to the left and go like this three times. So you just seek refuge with the shaitan, with Allah from the shaitan, and you blow like dry spit three times to your left. When you do ruku'ah, when you come to bow, make yourself feel how Allah is al-azim. He is, feel the majesty of Allah before you. Feel the greatness of Allah before you. And so that when you feel the greatness and glory of Allah, you want to glorify Him. Subhana bil-azim, subhana bil-azim, subhana bil-azim. And then when you go into sajda, you feel your poorness to Allah, your humbleness. How much are you in need for Allah? If Allah leaves you for 1 second, you won't be existing. Your breath will be cut off. Don't you realize every breath you take is from the mercy of Allah? Every beating of your heart is by the mercy of Allah. Can you control your breathing? Can you control your heart? So you are in the hand of Allah. Any second He can cut off your breath, He can cut off the beating of your heart. So your heart is beating by the mercy of Allah. Your breathing is by the mercy of Allah. Your brain operating is by the mercy of Allah. May Allah protect us. Any moment Allah can take our brains away from us. Any moment. May Allah bless us, Ya Rabbil Alameen, and keep all types of diseases and illnesses away from us. But any moment Allah can take away your sanity. So it's all by the mercy of Allah. So if you think about how much you're in need for Allah to protect you, how much you're in need for Allah to preserve you in this life and in the next, then say Subhana bil Ala, Subhana bil Ala, Subhana bil Ala. Glorify Him from your heart. Humble yourself in your sajda and call upon Him by His beautiful names. Make dua to Allah in your sajda. Take the opportunity to seek nearness to Allah in your sajda by calling upon Him. Ask Him, release your burdens. You have problems, release your problems onto your prayer mat. Don't, like they say, don't release your problems on your pillow. What is the use? Release the problems onto your release your problems in your sujood onto your prayer mat, because that is of use to you. Whereas crying on your prayer mat, crying on your pillow, what does that do? Nothing. This is the true way to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That, and then if you pray, imagine if you pray like this to Allah. Can you imagine? Don't you think that when you pray like that to Allah, when you leave your prayer, you're gonna feel different? Of course you are. You're going to feel uplifted. You're going to feel like my life is worth living. I can go on. Allah has given me the strength to go on. I can still keep going. You know, that's what the prayer is going to do for you, subhanAllah. Okay, so subhanAllah, like I said to you, the prayer without khushu is like a prayer without a soul. It's like a prayer without life in it. So if we want our prayers and we want to get the good effects of the prayer that benefit us in this life and the akhirah, then we have to pay attention to our prayers, focus on our prayers, make our prayers a priority for ourselves, sisters. SubhanAllah, I ask Allah Azza wa Jal, I ask Allah Tabarak Ta'ala that He makes us steadfast in our prayers. I ask Him to make us firm in praying our prayers in their times. I ask Him that He doesn't let us neglect our prayers and, you know, to miss our prayers. I ask Him to make us always remember Him. Let us always be in a state of remembering Him. To go to bed remembering Him. To wake up remembering Him. I ask Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala to help us to remember Him after our prayers. And to try to always be in a state of remembering Him day and night. Never forgetting Him. May Allah help us to make our prayers a means for us to relieve our hardships. May He help us to be close to Him through our prayers, so that we'll be close to Him on Yawm al-Qiyamah. I ask Him to help us to pray more prayers, so that we can be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Jannat al-Firdaws al-A'la. May He help us to live our whole life upon prayers, never neglecting our prayers until we take our final breath in this life. May Allah help us to meet Him in a state and to die upon a state of la ilaha illallah, of husnul khatima, of a good ending. May he give us all the best of endings, and may he unite us all with him in the Jannat al-Firdaws al-A'la. Wa qulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullahi li wa lakum wa subhanakallahu wa hamdik ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk inshallah.